his short 12-year career, Marc Bolan had 4 British number ones, 3 number one LPs, and was selling 60,000 records a day. He lived the iconic rock and roll dream, evolving from teenage mod pinup to rock god, idol to millions. I'm your toy, your 20th century boy. Ha!
Rock and roll's a bitch. I mean, you got to come on at a bitch. I mean, you can't be real. And I'm not the boy next door, yeah. So, in fact, on that stage, I'm at liberty. I'm in a realm of fantasy. I can do whatever I want to do and get away with it.
Marc made no secret of his ambition, fame. And thanks to his unique image and spectacular rock sound, he achieved just that. And 30 years on, his influence still reverberates.
If you play a T-Rex record now, they're as vibey as ever. They celebrate life, they celebrate sexuality, they celebrate fun.
He was Elvis, he was Cliff, he was Jimi Hendrix. He was the lot rolled into this strange new package.
Marc Bolan was born Marc Feld on September 30th, 1947, to parents Phyllis and Sid. Home was a working-class area of North London, Stoke Newington, where Marc and elder brother Harry grew up.
My mum and dad, they didn't have a lot of money. My mum worked in the market in Berwick Street. My dad was a lorry driver in our younger years, but nothing was too much for them. If they knew we wanted something, we'd have to wait, but they always managed to come up with the goods.
And Mum and Dad were able to give the 9-year-old Marc the guitar he wanted for his birthday, a choice inspired by the new 50s rock and roll icon Elvis Presley. But to the young Marc, a guitar was as much a fashion accessory as a musical instrument, and he soaked up images and ideas from his childhood heroes.
I think what I remember mostly about the visual aspect of rock and roll is A Girl Can't Help It, seeing that film, which I remember seeing Eddie Cochran, the way he held his guitar and moved, looked good, you know? I think Elvis was a man, because he really used to wiggle his bum. That influenced me incredibly, I think. I always used to be very impressed with the fact that he always had a guitar there, just sort of pushed it behind his back and threw it around. And, of course, the hair was very much part of a rock show, I think. Little Richard had about a 7-inch quiff, didn't he? And Elvis is, you know, was always so greased up, and it always had like a hole in the front of his quiff that used to blow my mind, you know? There ain't no cure for
the summertime blues. The teenage Marc created a style all of his own, influenced by the fashionable Soho clothes shops he liked to hang out in. And that desire to stand out from the crowd soon got him noticed.
Marc ended up in Town magazine in, I think it was September 1962. It was an issue devoted to youth. Precociously young, but immaculately dressed in, you know, top mod kind of gear. Everything carefully, you know, the exact amount of buttons, the button-down shirt, the vents at the back. I mean, whatever it took to make him look different.
I left school at 14. I was expelled.
Why were you expelled?
Well, it was very amicable. I just didn't think they were teaching me the things I wanted to know, so I didn't go too much in the end. Played truant all the time.
He did a couple of odd job things. He worked in the Wimpy Bar, I think, in a clothes shop. But in between, most of the time, he just carried on with his aim of getting into the music business at some time.
Attracted by the sound and images of the new pop industry, Marc hung out in places like the famous Two Eyes Coffee Bar, where rockers Tommy Steele and Cliff Richard had been discovered only a few years before. There were others with the same idea.
I met Marc Feld when I was about 15. And I just rented my first apartment in those days. Everybody came to the flat because, one, I was young, and two, it's a place to crash out. He got quite comfortable in this place, obviously so. Like most people, just moved in without asking, and never anything as vulgar as rent. He was obsessed by being famous. For hours and hours and hours, would be sitting cross-legged on the floor playing his little guitar and singing to himself. It occurred to me one day, because I was doing this little pop show thing called 5 o'clock Club, that maybe I could get him on the show. And then I thought, well, if I can get him on the show, then I could be, we should sign a contract, I'll be his manager. And he said, will you be my manager and get me on the show? And then we went to Regent Sound in Denmark Street, and he picked a song called Blowing in the Wind, which was Bob Dylan's song. How many roads must a man walk down before you can call?
Mark did style himself as a Dylan-style folky for a while. Also, it was quite easy to do. If you knew three chords, you could bash out a folk song. You listen to those multiple takes of Blowing in the Wind, and it's pretty grim. He hadn't really found, at all, he hadn't found his true voice yet.
When record companies passed on Blowing in the Wind, Mark moved on in search of new inspiration. In 1964, he set off for Paris with a new friend, American actor Riggs O'Hara. The trip made a huge impression on Mark and found its way into the evolving Marc Bolan myth.
Yeah, I used to know a guy in Paris who, in fact, was... he would be called a black magician, I suppose, but he wasn't. He's just a very learned man. He was into numerology and Egyptian magic. And I learned... he could levitate, you know, go off the floor. And he really could do it. Can I? No. Only when I'm drunk.
Back in London, Mark's memories of Paris inspired a new song which he touted around the record companies. Decca Records was interested enough to release The Wizard in 1965. The record also saw Mark Feld rename himself as Marc Bolan, a key step in the reinvention of the 18-year-old Londoner into a rock legend. Shadows follow. The Wizard single flopped, and Mark decided on a new approach. He sought out and joined manager Simon Napier Bell's roster of artists, who included the Yardbirds with Eric Clapton and Jimmy Page, and a new group, John's Children.
They lacked songs, and they really, in a way, they almost lacked a frontman as well. So he decided to install Bolan in John's Children as a kind of a Pete Townshend figure, the one with the brains and the songs as well.
And they wanted a folk poet, rock and roll, good-looking superstar, boogie-woogie, schmuck, you know. And I was around. So, it's one of those. I mean, you know, I could have been anyone. Uh-huh. But all that happened is that I wrote Desdemona, which is a dynamite song.
I don't think I was ever formally introduced to Mark. I don't think anybody at any time said to me personally.
But do you remember the time that we first got him down to our club and handed him an electric guitar? He's never played electric guitar before, ever.
It was literally a case of, here's the lead, and he put it into this stodgy SG, this thing, and suddenly this incredible bass splurge came out at an enormous volume. I remember when we first did Desdemona, he said it's kind of got a jailhouse rock feel. I thought, okay, don't... But this noise came out, and there is no way it could have ticked like jailhouse rock.
In April 1967, John's Children supported The Who on a German tour.
After a few numbers, you know, I'd just leap into the audience. Mark would be sort of having feedback from his guitar and smashing chains on the stage. John would be rolling around and I'd have a fight with him and we'd have blood capsules and, you know, rip all our clothes off. And then, of course, you know, riots eventually did ensue.
But the riots were the last straw for The Who's management and John's Children were thrown off the German tour.
Do you remember on the way back from Germany, we stopped off in Luxembourg?
Well, the car broke down, you know.
Well, no, we went and saw Ravi Shankar. Mark was really just sitting right there watching this, thinking,
on the carpet with the joss sticks. And so maybe he thought, well, actually, this is the route I need to go for a while.
Mark's last gig with John's Children was at the legendary 60s happening, the 14-hour Technicolor Dream at Alexander Palace in North London. Newly found footage shows a young Mark with the band.
Now, there's your good self.
Yeah.
That must be Mark.
This was the last gig that we did, wasn't it?
With Mark. I mean, there was absolutely no plan to play anything. It was just, OK, right, well, let's go on stage. It had gone by then. But I think that's probably why Mark disappeared. He wrote songs and he was into that, and much more serious than us.
After 3 or 4 months in John's Children, Bolan had enough of submerging himself and his personality in the band, Also, he realised what was happening at the time. There was a whole new movement growing on the underground where you could kind of take control yourself a little bit, a whole new network of clubs and that. So he decided he was going to then go back to his folk kind of roots with his beaten-up acoustic guitar, advertise for a like-minded kind of hippie soul, and who came in the form of Steve Took. And within a few weeks, they worked up this set of very, very voguish, whimsical, hippie kind of songs, reveling in amateurism in a way, but quite beautiful too.
The more intellectual folk music attracted a new audience to Marc. The idea for the name of his new group came from a book he'd read as a boy. Tyrannosaurus Rex was born. And regular gigs soon got them noticed.
I was asked by my boss, Denny Cordell, to find a group of my own to produce. I opened up the International Times. The first thing I saw was Tyrannosaurus Rex playing at Middle Earth. That evening, I went to see them. As I walked down the stairwell, I heard the sound of Tyrannosaurus Rex coming up towards me, and it was a beautiful sound. It was kind of rock, psychedelic, but it was two people playing acoustic music. I walked in the room, and the audience was mesmerized. I had never seen anything like this. About a week or two later, I asked Marc and Steve Peregrine Took to come to my flat in Earl's Court, and I had one of the first stereo tape recorders that was for domestic use. I set the mics up, and Steve and Marc just sat on the floor in front of this little mic, and they just played their entire set. Played those demos to my boss just to remind him how good the band was, and then we signed them shortly afterwards.
My friends and I saw them several times in 68, 69. I used to know Marc's playing as sitting cross-legged on the floor with an acoustic guitar and a guy on the conga drums. I was a huge fan. I loved his airy-fairy nonsense. I loved it.
All these songs about elves and things like that, and this bleating Larry the Lamb voice was charming. There would be girls there in sort of hippie-type floaty dresses. May I read your tarot? A guy trying to lay acid or hash on you.
Marc was meeting more and more people in the music business, and one of them would go on to take an active role in both his professional and personal life.
June Child, as she was then, was a secretary for Black Hill Enterprises, who were this up-and-coming hippie underground management company. And Marc was there in the office one day. I think they immediately met and hit it off. She was a little bit older than Marc. She was very, very confident and worldly. She was useful to him, as well as, you know, being someone that he could kind of fall in love with and idealize at the same time.
He and his wife, June, used to come to my flat and take their weekly bath. They lived in a one-room squat in Notting Hill Gate, and they didn't have a bathtub. They had, like, a communal toilet out in the hall, and they used to come to my house once a week. They'd have the bath, but before the bath, we'd play guitar all night, we'd drink a bottle of wine, we'd listen to Beach Boys records, and I think that was the best time ever.
Tony brought another of his friends along to spend evenings at his flat with Marc, June, and Steve.
David Bowie was my friend. We were all hanging out, and there were many nights where David and Marc would come over to my flat, as they were both living with their parents, and they'd come over and we'd jam and all that.
Marc Bolan and David Bowie had known each other for about 3 years, from being both ex-mods on the make. They were now both budding underground figures on the make. And Visconti was their enabler then. He was producing both. They were both vying for Tony Visconti to be their lead kind of person. Visconti actually went with Bolan first.
So at the age of 21, Marc was finally in the studio recording his own songs for his very first album, My People Were Fair.
It was the first time I went into the studio and made an album. And Marc was kind of very green in the studio, so was I. We had a budget of 4 days in the studio. And let's face it, in 4 days, you can't get up to many tricks. So we carefully rehearsed the album in my flat, and we worked out in detail what the overdubs were going to be. And we went in and we did our best. Those sessions produced Deborah, which was Marc's first hit single. It was a minor hit, and it got his name about, and certainly we broke some ground with that. And we got a great ally, of course, John Peel, who was one of the DJs who repeatedly played Deborah over and over again.
Jimmy Young suggested on the radio the other day that I was Tyrannosaurus Rex, and if he's listening this evening, he's really going to appreciate this next trick. This one is Deborah.
John Peel fell in love with Tyrannosaurus Rex and would play their records on the radio to the point of annoyance to many listeners, and was very supportive and helped break them.
John Peel saw Marc as some kind of a hippie guru, mystical, beautiful person who fell from heaven to earth, you know, which was a great way to see Marc. Marc just certainly had those qualities. He really believed in Marc, and without John Peel's support, we would have never gotten any airplay whatsoever.
Well, once or twice a week, Marc comes round to festive Peel Acres, and we sit there and listen to old Ricky Nelson records, and we listen to Eddie Cochran and Gene Vincent and early Elvis Presley things. Marc going through his second childhood, me through my third or fourth.
Encouraged by the success of the first album, Marc's songwriting became prolific. A second album was released only 3 months later, and a third quickly followed in May of 1969.
Yes, it was love, he's a law we trust in him to move like the wind, Joseph and Carly. The elements and oceans congregate on his brow. He moves in style like a rock of a dog. We put him down, 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 down. We put him down.
Marc and Steve were a true 50-50 partnership. Steve was a remarkable musician. He could play many, many instruments. He played percussion, he could pick up a bass or a guitar. He would also sometimes play some cello parts. And then his backing vocals were great too.
But after only 2 years together, all was not well with the duo. Cracks in the relationship began to appear when Steve was arrested on a drugs possession charge.
The second factor is Steve did the unspeakable thing. He said, I want to do some of my songs. That will always break up a group.
There's only one star in any group that Marc Bolan's ever been in. So Steve got the heave.
Were you and Peregrine took of one mind when you started
out?
Not at
all, no. It was just basically something to do, and we did it for about three albums. But we were fated not to stay together, very obviously.
Mickey Finn was brought in almost immediately after Steve Peregrine took left. June and Marc held auditions. They put an advert in the Melody Maker, and June phoned me up and said, we found someone who's perfect. He's so good-looking. And I said, well, can he play, you know?
Unlike Steve Took, Mickey Finn couldn't really play the bongos very well, but he was a perfect foil for Bolan visually. But the main thing also was that he just did what Marc told him to do.
The music has become much, much more rhythmic because Mickey is a very different sort of percussionist. The rhythm section before was always very loose. Yeah. Now we're very, very tight. The music is much, much tighter rhythm.
But the change of personnel had little effect on Marc's focus, and within a year, a new album was out. It heralded a new sound for the new duo.
A Beard of Stars was a big turning point. He had enough money, he got his own electric guitar, and he had been studying Hendrix and Clapton. So his guitar playing was getting stronger and stronger as a result of all this study. I mean, he was really methodical. He just didn't pick up a guitar and pose with it. He really played guitar.
Marc's A Beard of Stars album actually isn't far away from being on a par with Revolver. It's a masterpiece, a seminal album. And that's when he first played on record electric guitar. That was his Les Paul going crazy on Elemental Child is something to behold. It's a fantastic record.
Touch girl of the marshes, her kiss is a whip of the moon. Dawn's dance is a dancing to the hum of a sunny young tune. Oh, oh, elemental child. Oh, oh, yeah, yeah.
The change to a more electric sound demanded adding a bass player. Steve Curry was signed up, and Tyrannosaurus Rex was reinvented as T-Rex.
I've been playing the electric guitar for a while, and I was beginning to feel some sort of liquidness with my mental outlook and the guitar. You know, I wasn't getting enough out of the acoustic guitar anymore. And it was a natural progression eventually just to have it, whatever I felt like in my head, coming out on the records, which turned out to be Rider White Swan.
Marc actually changed his songwriting style. It was a very direct, communicative song. It was a simple message. The lyrics are all about a wizard and a magical hat and riding a white swan, full of wonderful Tolkien imagery. But the guitar was straight off an Elvis Presley record. And we released that just like we released the six previous singles. I get a phone call, and we couldn't believe it. She said, "Your record's number two." That was it. That was the, our lives changed from that moment.
Marc and Tony together were fantastic. They were brilliant. Because Tony brought things to the table, like his wonderful string arrangements, for example, as well as his sonic abilities. And Marc had the songs and he had the attitude, you know, and he had the band.
Tony, to me, is what every record producer should be. Mm-hmm. He's your main man. Tony spends all his time studying what I want to hear, man.
Okay, I have in front of me the 8-track master of Rider White Swan. What you're going to hear at first is the whole mix of the song. You'll hear the beautiful sound of an analog machine starting up, which has now been transferred to digital, but you can actually hear the pop of the machine starting up. So, here we go.
What's it called, Marc? Rider White Swan. Call it White Swan for the minute.
White Swan, take one. Roll it.
A bird in the sky was riding all out like you were a bird. Fly it all out like an eagle in a sunbeam. Ride it all out like you were a bird.
Okay, so that much you already know. You've heard the record many, many times. So the first thing we should do is listen to the basic guitar. This was the first guitar that Marc laid down. I put some slapback echo like you would hear on an Elvis record. I'll solo the track. You hear that little bit of flutter? That is a vibe. When you hear that, you play to that, you go, yeah, it's a rock and roll sound. Don't you wish you had this at home? And when Marc heard that, that's the sound that Marc says, that's the sound I want. And then everything kind of fell into place after that.
Well, I got the sound. I was getting the sound with the tape echo just to make sure it would sound good that way.
Okay, thank you, man. I want that sound, you know?
She's not a woman of gold, she's not very old, she's not.
To enhance that magic T-Rex studio sound, drummer Bill Legend was brought in as a finishing touch to the T-Rex lineup. And Marc finally achieved his first number one hit record.
The reaction to Hot Love becoming number one was possibly even greater than Rider White Swan getting up to number two, not because of the different chart position, but because it was confirmation that we could do it again.
Hot Love stayed at number one for a staggering 6 weeks.
We were selling something like 50 to 60,000 singles a day. I mean, people would now love to sell 60,000 singles in all. We knew it. We knew how to make hit records. That was confirmation, and we were loving every minute of it.
Get it on, then I'm gone. Get it on.
he changed from this sort of mystical troubadour and made this transformation into this sort of pop monster, which involved a complete change of music and a completely different sound and a completely different audience, really.
But some felt that he had sold his musical soul for chart success.
Some Tyrannosaurus Rex fans, when Mark went electric, as if he'd never played an electric guitar in his life before, were sort of disappointed. They felt that Mark sells out. He's now joined the rest of the rock and roll twangers.
I think, to be honest with you, I liked the acoustic Tyrannosaurus Rex more than the electric one because I didn't think Mark was awfully good at it, to be perfectly honest. I mean, I just thought he was better doing strummity, strummity, strum on an acoustic guitar. And when he started doing his kind of cock rock macho posing stuff, it just looked, I thought, a bit silly, to be honest.
I've always been a better electric guitarist than I was an acoustic guitarist, anyway. And I just wanted people to know that. Had I not done what I'm doing now, had I stuck with Tyrannosaurus Rex, I'd end up like Cat Stevens, which is not what I want to be. I'm not trying to be a cock rock star.
By fine-tuning his own unique sound and with his records going straight to number one, Mark had finally developed into the teenage idol he had always so wanted to be.
I saw Marc Bolan, I think I was about 13 years old. It was the beginning of the 70s. And in a concert, he got down on his knees and he played his guitar with a tambourine, like very Hendrix kind of, throwing back his head, and he did those kind of phallic guitar movements that he did. And it was just, the sound was just so overwhelming at that time, the electricity of the sound. I remember getting up in the aisle. I was an idiot dancing in the aisle and just overwhelmed by the electric guitar of Marc Bolan and T-Rextasy. It was that moment of T-Rextasy. He was the biggest thing for a while in this country. And he had a particular sound and great lyrics, you know. They're great, great pop songs, I think, you know.
It's been an exciting year, and I think kids for a long time have wanted to really like boogie at concerts. I mean, it hasn't been a band for a long time that's actually gone out and done that. We started out as an underground band, supposedly, or a minority band, and we've become like the biggest media band for like 5 years or something. Which for me is really weird, because many people used to say, you know, Mark, with your funny little voice, man, you know, you're never going to sell any records.
Publicist B.P. Fallon came up with a phrase that the media leapt upon to describe the T-Rex phenomena.
I regard you have to enter the sacred palace, you know, and in order to enter the sacred palace, you need the password. And the Beatles had it fantastically with Beatlemania. In one word, it described what was going on. We were in the train one day going to a gig somewhere, and it just came. It looked like typeset on fire. T-Rextasy.
It was an amazing time. I mean, every single newspaper had a picture of Marc Bolan on the cover, on the inside. There were interviews. Now the same DJs who ignored him 2 years earlier were now playing his records non-stop.
Everyone wanted Marc Bolan at that stage. It was, you know, it actually got quite dangerous on the road where you've got fans there with scissors actually chasing him, wanting a lock of that iconic hair that he had.
He did love being famous. He knew what he wanted, and I think he just went for it. And it was all very instinctive, I think.
It was exactly what Bolan wanted, what he strived to achieve, what he dreamed of since he was young. A magnified version of himself reflected back to him.
You know, he always said that he wanted to be the star. So from about 9 or 10, he was self-educated. Even in the music business, he used to pick people's brains and use it later on to help him on.
I mean, the truth is, he didn't take himself and the art form seriously. It was a game he was playing, and he had a game plan, I think, and he mixed with professionals that he listened to. But I'm not sure he took it all at all seriously. It was a vehicle for Mark to appear in public and be a, you know, a star. That was what mattered to him.
I always wanted to be a teenage idol. I think every person wants to be. It's lovely to be worshipped and all that, as long as it's real.
Fame brought idolation on a scale not seen since the heady days of Beatlemania. Friend and ex-Beatle Ringo Starr decided to capture the hysteria on film.
You can see clearly in the Born to Boogie film that the concerts were as unruly as Beatles concerts. People were screaming nonstop. I mean, right through the songs, right through the introductions.
It was very interesting, the changing of the guard, you know, between Beatles and T-Rex, because there you had all these people in the audience at the Wembley Empire Pool going completely bonkers, having the time of their lives. And there, in between the crash barrier and the stage, was this chap with the beard urging on his camera crew enthusiastically, and no one really noticed him, and that was Ringo. And the Beatles had been the big cheese, and now the big fromage was Mark. But Ringo was helping him put his crown on. And that was a kind of a beautiful moment.
To have a Beatle shooting Marc Bolan was for him like an ultimate accolade. You had him jamming in Apple Studios with Elton and Ringo. So, a sense again that he'd really, really made it.
To what do you attribute your success, though, Mark?
Playing the right music at the right time. I do think that we are good at what we do. We've been really the only real visual band to come out of England that was made music for the kids for 4 years, 5 years.
I think it was Mark who was really responsible for opening the door to people like Bowie as well. He really opened that door to the 70s, and he was that bridge from the 60s to the 70s, from the 60s hippieism and the kind of hippie rock to the pop of the 70s. And Mark kind of made it okay for you to like pop music.
With his stellar status, Mark could now give full rein to his passion for look, style, and glamour. His sensational new image exploded onto the pop scene. It was light years away from the long-haired, denim-clad look of the 70s.
But you do dress up when you go on Top of the Pops, for example.
No, I mean, clothes that I wear on there, I wear normally. If I'm doing something like that and there's someone's dad watching, I want to get some reaction from him, you know, whether he thinks I'm just a little queer or a chick or just someone freaked out.
One of the earlier books that Mark read was Beau Brummel, and that's where he started getting the ideas of cravats, which weren't in vogue at the time we're talking about. He would design weird jackets and things like that. That's where he got the cloaks from in the early Tyrannosaurus Rex days.
Mark was a peacock, completely obsessed with clothes and his look, and by 1971, Chilita Secunda, who was the ex-wife of his manager at the time, came into his life and started to, you know, take him to different clothes shops, gave him a new kind of glam dimension to his wardrobe.
Nothing could have been more glam than introducing Mark to up-and-coming fashion designer, Zandra Rhodes.
Mark was definitely a larger-than-life person, accented by being in touch with someone like Chilita, who was definitely an exotic person. She decided to come to me for me to do some of Mark's new imagery. I think that Mark was an early forerunner of the glam rock with the makeup and the way he looked and being styled in women's clothes. These were definitely distinctive and unique. These were one-of-a-kind pieces.
He made it acceptable to be glamorous and to wear ambiguously sexual clothing, and he really fully embraced it.
Marc Bolan was
the epitome of what a rock star should look like. He wore things that were really sort of revolutionary. And of course, everybody copied him.
The makeup came just for fun, really. And interestingly enough, then you had people like the Stones, you know, suddenly all, you know, wearing eye makeup and stuff like that. And so it went beyond Mark and T-Rex and everything. It actually had a social impact.
Certainly, there's been a change in England in 2 years, and we are part of the change. I mean, guys now can wear makeup. They can shout and scream.
The look, sound, and style Mark had created was given the label glam rock, and it came to dominate the early 70s.
He was very, very image conscious. He was very good at marketing, regardless of how foolish he may have looked in his feather boas and high-heeled shoes and stuff.
With a succession of hits in the UK, Mark was now determined to break the lucrative American market.
We're off to the States soon to do a tour. We're playing for big stadiums and stuff. And I'm going to use chick singers and I just want a bigger sound, you know?
Key to creating that bigger sound was employing a new backing singer from a very different musical background. Gloria Jones had had a hit in 1964 with Tainted Love, but it was her work as a performer, producer, and songwriter at Motown Records that both attracted Mark and influenced his sound.
Gloria brought into Mark this fantastic soul influence into his music, gave it another dimension and took it to another level.
Mark had the tunes, he had the talent, you brought your element. He was creative, artistic. He was before his time.
T-Rex struggled to make an impact in America, but back home in the UK, Mark was as popular as ever.
When Mark found fame, I think, you know, he was on top of the world and at the top of his game. I think the shine started to come off fairly soon, though. I mean, he started to sort of celebrate with the fruits of all the fame as well, all the hobnobbing with the stars, all the champagne, all the cognac, all the cocaine, which was kind of becoming a staple diet of rock and rollers at that time. That really, I think, was the beginning of the downfall as well. It didn't take too long before that started to bite.
Mark and I put away, just the two of us, God knows what he got up to with other people, but Mark and I put away what you put away in the mid-70s. By the bottle load and by the gram. It's what we did.
He was losing grip on his beauty, on his innocence. The drug abuse and the alcohol abuse was making him grow old. He had 20 bottles of champagne and a boiled chicken in the fridge. It was sad, you know, it was the beginning of this new period where he was turning into, like, I guess in many ways he was mirroring Elvis's life, you know. Now he was getting ugly.
We sold 60 million records or something last year. I know we did that, so I know that people are into what we're doing, right? Well, there's a lot of hassles. The pressure of every time you make a record, it's expected to be a number one record. These things, if you think about them, can do you in.
In previous years, Mark had occasionally strayed from wife June, always to return. His affair with Gloria was to be rather different.
Now, the few times that Mark left June, he jumped into an affair with another woman. And I was guilty twice of introducing him to women. June, of course, found out. I mean, Mark told her, and she was extremely hurt. And I think the third time it happened, I think it was Gloria.
The relationship started, I can remember, we were in Chicago and we were sitting in the limousine. And that's when he made this decision that we were gonna come together. It was hard because Mark's wife knew, my husband knew, and everyone started to kind of see that it was going on, you know, so.
June was the typical rock, I'm with the band type girl, groupie at heart. So when he met Gloria, it was all about, you know, I've been there, done that. Now let's really talk a musician to musician.
With Gloria, Mark had never been happier. But his musical output was becoming stagnant and predictable.
I think he just got sloppy. He wasn't changing his style much. And he was underestimating his audience. He, for those three golden albums, Electric Warrior, The Slider, and Tanks, he had the audience. But Tanks didn't sell as much, and it was slipping. To me, I mean, that was an indication to change the style, because essentially those three albums sounded the same. And it was he himself who let the fans slip through his fingers.
You can't keep going back, and this was what happened to T-Rex. He did keep chucking out the same kind of hot love for three or four years, and it went against him in the end. They turned on him.
You're sticking to a very basic energy rock formula.
I don't accept that you can play Children of the Revolution, which is a very slow song with 44 string players on it, and play me 20th Century Boy, which is basically just a rock and roll band, and compare them as the two.
But as far as the public is concerned, do you think there's going to come a time when Marc Bolan will have to change?
Marc Bolan is changing, it's just that people aren't really listening. The kids are, they know. That's why they're still buying the records. We're 3 years in now, man. Hmm. 24 million records.
Can you see that this repetitive riff is going to change, that you're going to do something totally different?
I've just done it in the new album. It's just that, you know, when you hear it, you know what I mean. And then you say, man, why are you doing something so different? You watch.
There was a kind of little bit of a desperation already about Mark by that stage, and I think, you know, his ego did go into hyperdrive at that stage, boosted by drinking drugs.
I was in mental pain during the making of Zinc Alloy. There was no cohesiveness to it. It wasn't exactly adventurous. It was just kind of sloppy recording and all that. This was one of the things that sealed off fate. He came in after a take, and I said, Mark, would you mind tuning up your guitar? It's a little out of tune. He delivered a tirade of abuse on me. He goes, F you, my guitar isn't out of tune. You're effing deaf, or something like that. And it was because there were people in the room. We had some groupies in the room, some friends. My face turned red. I mean, I was really, like, so hurt by that. So I just swallowed my pride. When he was out in the room with the groupies, I went out into the lobby. I took his guitar and I tuned it. And when he came back, he played it. He knew it was tuned up. Things like that were happening. I said, this is getting too much like Elvis, and I don't want to be part of a posse, and I don't want to be treated like this, especially when I met him when he was this cheruby young kid. So I talked to Mark about drinking, about using cocaine. Fell on deaf ears. I didn't want to sabotage the album. I finished it, wrote him a letter saying I resigned. Due to your abusiveness, the way you speak to people, the way you've treated me, I gave him the reasons. I said, I resign. He never phoned me up. He never answered the letter. And according to Steve Curry, the next time they were together in the studio or a rehearsal, he just said, Tony's not with us anymore. That was it. No explanation in that.
Mark's stage act could still show the performance extravagances he'd learned with John's children. But now he seemed to be merely going through the motions.
There was a stage when he started to look like a football, you know, because he wasn't very tall and he got bloated, living the good life, I guess.
Sometimes people lose the plot a little bit, you know, which is fine. Nothing wrong in losing the plot. What is important is what happens after that. Do you become Fat Elvis all your life?
Everyone is paranoid. Every number one you get, the next one that follows, you've got to top it, man. Yeah. Or you ain't hot. It never stops. The mania is it never fucking stops, man. How many number one records do you get to be secure when there's no security?
After a lackluster and lethargic U.S. tour at the end of 1974, percussionist Mickey Finn left T-Rex. And with his fans deserting him, Mark was advised by his accountants to spend time out of the UK as a tax exile.
Mid-70s, Bolan was out in Monte Carlo, hiding from the tax man, hiding from the audience that kind of didn't want him anymore either. Becoming this kind of recluse in a, you know, Marlene Dietrich, Garbo, Rolling Stones, tax exile kind of thing, hoping perhaps that, you know, it'll create a bigger market when he came back home.
Monte Carlo was a place where he was able to reflect. He did a lot of reading, and he started practicing his licks. He was very hurt that he was not able to stay in the country. That's another reason that he always felt that he lost his fans, too.
But an offer from the UK gave Mark the chance to appeal to a whole new generation of fans and an opportunity to really go to town with his glam rock image.
Well, Mark, by this stage, I mean, he always valued an audience. So when the offer came in from Mike Mansfield to appear on Supersonic, which was a children's show in the mid-70s, despised by rock and progressive rock fans and heavy rock fans, but, you know, for him, that was a place where he could actually find a home again.
What Supersonic offered them was the chance at least to move around a studio and to sort of take part in this adventure, this sort of rock and roll musical extravaganza.
And roll Supersonic. Stand by Slick, stand by Marc Bolan, stand by John Miles.
Mark was always a kind of a no person. He didn't relish going over the past, I don't think. He was always looking forward.
One moment I remember was when he said to me, what are you going to do to me next, Mike? And I said, well, we're going to build a swan for you in the studio. And he said, well, what are you going to do with it? And I said, well, you're going to ride this swan around the studio. And we filled the studio with dry ice, and he came in and he saw this white swan and he just simply couldn't believe it. Get your head start and place it on your forehead,
see if it spells and baby, there you go. There were those around Mark who encouraged the super posy performance.
His presentation was very often unnecessarily over the top.
I did try to talk him out of it and try to suggest to him he should temper his performance a little more with the slightly more serious Mark, you know.
If that was the only film left of Marc Bolan, I would be very disappointed.
Mark was sort of pop theatre, and he was made for Supersonic. Supersonic was made for him.
With his performing appetite back, Mark decided it was time to do something about his other appetites.
We went to the health farm, and they told him that his heart was of a 70-year-old man. And that's when he realized, oh, I have worked 10 years. I haven't taken one vacation. I have done nothing but create, write, record, and not live. And so that was the first beginning of, I've got to become healthy. Then the baby, I must live for my child.
You've just become a father. How do you feel? Do you feel different?
I'm still waiting to feel different, but I'm still waiting to grow up, you know. And I haven't done that yet. No, it's lovely. I helped deliver the baby as well. Mm. It's called Roland Bolan. Roland Seymour Bolan. And he weighed about 6'6" when he came out. And it was really cute, because, I mean, it looks like me, so it was really... And it's an amazing thing.
Yeah,
I'm hoping it's
going to
stabilise me somehow.
When Roland was born, he gave up booze. And he lost all of the weight. And he says, you know what, all that money we spent at the health clinic, all I had to do was just stop making those martinis and... I mean, but that was Mark.
The birth of baby Roland Bolan gave Mark a new lease of life and rekindled his enthusiasm for music. 1976 saw the release of the futuristic Dragon album and Dandy in the Underworld the following year. The days of T-Rextacy were long gone. Mark responded to the new landscape with a tighter and more accomplished T-Rex lineup.
Mark had a new T-Rex on board, basically made up of very competent session musicians, a couple of whom he poached from David Bowie, which he was particularly pleased about. So it was a cleaner, actually more orthodox T-Rex sound.
Suddenly we had this real red-hot, groovy little band.
that was quick and simple. Rock and roll, yeah. Even stone it, baby.
Rock and roll, yeah. When he put the band together with Herbie, he was very comfortable with that sound. And what he liked was that they liked music. They liked playing music. They liked creating and finding new sounds.
Sometimes, after he got the groove and showed us what to do, he'd go in the box as the producer and sit and listen. He'd press the button and say, hole in one. That meant keep that take. And the engineer might say, oh, shall we do a safety master? He'd say, I'm the master. Yeah, he's all right.
By 1977, a new raw sound was emerging on the music scene. Punk would leave many established pop acts out in the cold. Marc acted fast and made the bold decision to ask the punk group The Damned to tour with him.
The Damned does seem an odd choice for Bolan to tour with, but at the time, like all the old-timers, he was shocked by punk at first and didn't know what to do with it. Then he realised that he could nail his mask to it.
Everyone said, hey, Mark, you're crazy to do these places. We played them, we sold them all out. The Rainbow was sold out real quick, everywhere real quick. And they said, hey, they're a punk audience, my audience. I mean, it was three quarters Marc Bolan audience, a quarter Damned, and it ended up 100% a rock and roll fan club.
I wouldn't think for a second that Marc was a big Damned fan, personally. I would think that it was very convenient for him to take them on a tour to put bums on seats. He was as cynical as any marketing man is. And I say it as his mate. I would say it to him. I used to joke to him about it. I'd say, well, you know, you're cashing in there, boy. Yeah, I know, but put bums on seats, wouldn't it?
It may have been a smart commercial move, but Marc was genuinely attracted by the attitude underlying the new wave.
He kind of sneered at the world, and he kind of sneered at his kind of curled lip. And I think the people who came up in punk kind of recognised that, and they felt that affinity.
He really got behind it, and of course it allowed him to say, I'm the godfather of punk. You know, it allowed him to restyle himself, and he'd been doing that all the way through his career. Marc the mod, Marc the Dylan beatnik, Marc the hippie, Marc the glam rock star, Marc the interstellar soul guy, Marc the husband, and then suddenly Marc the godfather of punk.
With the tour over, Marc was offered his own TV series, simply called Marc. It gave many new bands their first taste of television, introduced by Marc in his own inimitable way.
This is a new group called Generation X, who have a lead singer called Billy Idol, who's supposed to be as pretty as me. We'll see now. Generation X. One, two, three. I want to tell you that what you have to do when you get a new wave band on the set is funk them up. You've got to go, be outrageous. Come on, rip your knickers off. Do whatever you're going to do. If you've got it, show it.
An old friend of Marc's in television, Muriel Young, actually gave Marc the Granada TV show. Again, it was the children's straight back from school TV slot, but Marc would take any slot that was kind of going. But, you know, for him, that was a place where he could actually find a home again. The other interesting thing about that is that Bolan always believed in the power of pop music on children, because that's what inspired him as a young boy. Seeing Elvis, it was an invitation into this strange new world. So it appealed to his vanity. They're going to see me, you know, with my corkscrew locks.
The very last thing that we did with Marc, David Bowie was the special guest on the Marc programme, and we all felt there was a little bit of extra adrenaline flying about just because two greats on the same programme.
Thank you for goodbye and all the boys in the band, David, everybody, all the cats, you know who they are. This is a new song.
One, two, three, yeah!
But the last show in the series was to end not with a bang, but a whimper. It was at the very end of the last studio day and had to be a single take. Marc fell off the stage, leaving the final shot of his last show to a rather bemused David Bowie. A few days after the recording of this last Marc TV show, Gloria returned from the States. After a night of celebrations, she was driving the couple back to their home in South London.
They'd had a night on the town. They'd been to the speakeasy. They'd been for a meal. They were driving home. behind them was Gloria's brother Richard, and he went over this humpback bridge in Barnes, only to look ahead of him and not see Gloria's car continuing on, but actually just the smoke pouring out of it as it had veered off the side and crashed into a tree.
I went to the tree and already people had started putting little mementos of Mark by the tree. There was glass and blood on the road. And I picked some of that up. There was no one else there at this point in time. And then it was just the tree and then this girl appeared, this gorgeous girl. And I found myself chatting her up. And then, ding, this thing happened, you know, and I could imagine Mark sitting there saying, "You fucker, you know, there you are, you're gonna, you know, I died today, and there you're going, and you're looking at the tree and you're chatting up a bird, you know, and laughing." And then it was all right, you know, then it was all right. And one realized that one had lost the physical continuity of a friend. But it doesn't mean you actually have to lose them, you know. It's very sad. But I like where he is now. He is very helpful to me.
There is a touch of T-Rex in most groups. If it's maybe a lick or two, or maybe it's just the spirit, the vitality of T-Rex, to have music that high and that aggressive and that joyful. There's something about Mark and everybody, like he's really left a big legacy behind.
Marc Bolan in three words: magic, magnetic, alive.
Talent, generosity, sexy.
Rock and roll punk.
He was a beautiful, kind man.
Beautiful. Profound. Spiritual.
My favorite performer.
Realistic. Mark was clever, but he had a lot of love. He was of love.
I miss him.
Middle of the room, is it you? Middle of the room, is it you?
It's Back to the 70s next on BBC4 with glam rockers T-Rex in concert. Then at 1:40, our award-winning political satire, The Thick of It special, Rise of the Nutters. Stay with us. It's a true, yeah.